Hi, everybody. Welcome to the last seminar of this Master on Quantum Computing Technologies. Today, we have with us Ana Martín, the CSO of Quantum Maths, which is going to talk about the the digital analog paradigm of quantum computing. Welcome, Ana. Thank you for coming.
Hello, thank you for having me. So if it's fine by you, I will start my presentation now. Let me share my screen. Okay. So as Alejandro have told you, my name is Ana Martín, and I am the CSO with S of from scientist, not strategy, in quantum maths. And also I am a PhD student at the QT Center, which is soon to be Enquire Group, in the University of the Basque Country, which is located at the north of Spain. You have already met two of my colleagues in quantum maths, who are the CEO, Javier González Conde, and Giancarlo Gatti. But today I will tell you more about my PhD, my PhD thoughts and my PhD research, which is focused on the quantum computing topic, but more concrete, it is focused in the digital analog quantum computational paradigm, which I don't know if you are familiar with, but I hope that at the by the end of this session, you will at least know what is it all about. But first, before telling you anything about my PhD research, I would like to talk to you a little bit about my personal experience doing the PhD and some personal thoughts that I think that might be useful for all of you, and some advices that I got once I was inside the PhD research, but I would have loved to listen to them before starting it. So let me start by my personal experience. And well, first let's start by what is a PhD. Normally, people first start studying a bachelor degree during 4 years, more or less. Then they study a master degree, and some of them start what it is called the third cycle studies, which are the PhD or Doctor of Philosophy, which is what this letter stands for. But there is a really huge difference between what is expecting from you in both the bachelor and the master degree, and what is expecting from you once you are inside the PhD. And the difference is that when you are in the first part of your studies in the bachelor and master degree, what you are doing is acquire some knowledge. You are getting knowledge, you are learning stuff, you are like a sponge and you are absorbing knowledge. But once you start the PhD, they expect you to generate knowledge. And this is an important point, and this is a huge difference between the first part of the studies and the second part. There are some people that start the PhD thinking that they are going to learn even more about a topic they love, but I think by my personal experience that's not the best approach one can have for the PhD, because the main goal for you to have to defend your PhD thesis and become a doctor is for you to generate something unique in the field of study. It might be science, it might be literature, whatever the field is, they are expecting from you that you are contributing with some new knowledge. So once you decide that you don't want to focus, once you decide that you are able to focus on some topic and generate some knowledge about it, I suggest you to use these four tips that I hope that someone have given me sooner. And the first tip would be for you to do an introspection exercise. So ask yourself three questions. The first one would be, is the PhD suitable for me? Am I a specialist or a generalist? Because the PhD is all about specializing in one topic, in one tiny topic of a big field. It's not about knowing a lot of things of a really big topic. You are going to be a specialist. So if you rather be a generalist, it's completely fine, but you have to know this difference that I was telling you before. Next, why do I want to study a PhD? Do I plan to stay in the university or do I want to be part of a company? If you want to stay in the university, a PhD is something that you have to go through. There's no other way around, although it's not enough, but it's needed. But if you want to be part of a company, well, a PhD is not going to be an easy path to get to it. It's, of course, a possible path to follow, but in company, the focus is different. You don't exactly need to have a PhD to succeed in the company world. And then, am I capable to keep my level of motivation for the next 3 to 4 years? Because remember that you are going to be focusing on a concrete topic for the next 3 to 4 years. So it's such a long time to dedicate to something that you don't enjoy or you are not interested in. The next tip I would have liked to listen to is to find a topic that you love. And I say love and not like, and it's related to the last question I suggest you to make yourself. So start by finding a topic that you love, something that entertains you, moves you, something that you are happy to dedicate time to. And once you have it or have an idea, then is the time to look for the places where you can develop it and not the other way around. I mean that if you want to stay in academia and if you want to stay, for example, in the Politecnica of Madrid, the UPM where you are, don't try to adjust the topic you like to the researching lines they have, because maybe the topic that you like, it's not inside that university, and maybe you have to change country, change the university, and that's fine, but don't do it the other way around. Start by what you want to study and then look for the place that where you can do it. And also invest some time looking for a thesis director compatible to you. So she or he has to be competent in the field. She has to make you feel comfortable, and she has to be able to dedicate you enough quality time, because sometimes PhD directors are focusing so many different things and they are not able, even though they want, to dedicate you enough time. So invest, once you have find the place where you want to study, invest some little more time looking for the thesis director you want to have. And finally, attitude is key. I mean, the way you tell yourself how the things are happening is even more important than the things that are actually happening to you. This is a long path that mainly lasts for the next 4 years of your life. And I mean, you have to stay with a positive mind. In my case, I would say that for me, the PhD is similar as another work, in the sense that there are some things that I find boring. There are some things that I don't like to do, like bureaucratical stuff and blah, blah, blah. But there is something important, which is it is about dedicating time to something that I enjoy. And that's important. And that thing, you can have it both in the PhD and in the company world. In quantum maths, I am part of quantum maths precisely because of that, because I am able to dedicate time to something that I enjoy, something that I like, which is quantum computing, and bringing it closer to the companies and bringing it closer to the industrial field. So I think that the PhD is such a nice path, but it's not the only path. And I think that the key points are similar to all of the different words, different options that you might have. And last, if you decide to make a PhD, it's different than the company. I mean, maybe when you start at a company, you think that you are starting a point and maybe you are finishing at some other part inside the company. But this is not how this is worked here in the academia world. I mean, this straight line is not going to happen. More or less, you will have this kind of spiral thing where you orbit around your objective, which is becoming a doctor or becoming an expert on a field. Sometimes you're going to feel that you are going far from your objective, but if you keep an optimist attitude, I am sure that you will be able to manage it. Maybe this situation also is that you can face it in any other aspect in life, but well, if for the PhD career, I think it's useful to know that you are not going to be straightforward directed to the doctor star. You will be having some roundups. And well, this is all from my side about my personal experience during the PhD. But as I mean, for me, it's such a fun path to follow. And I don't regret a bit of it, especially because I am part also of quantum math. So I can do both of the things. So be focusing one topic, but trying to be a generalist. I will tell you about it in the future about how is it going. But now let me tell you about my PhD research. And this is digital analog quantum computation. So I have looked at the syllabus of your master, and I know that you have, of course, studied what quantum computing is. So I am not going to bore you telling you it was originated in the 80s. Physicists were starting to speculate about the computational models that can integrate the laws of quantum mechanics. You already know that in the last 40 to 50 years, the scientists and the engineers are converging towards the study and the development of quantum algorithms and their experimental realization. We have different kinds of quantum computers, and we are getting closer to this reality. And quantum computing, it was introduced as a possible way to solve problems that are related to science, technology, engineering. And the point of quantum computing, it was that it was able to go beyond existing classical computers. So they can solve problems that now current devices are not able to, current classical devices. But to carry out this task, these two tasks, we need two different things, and they are indispensable. We need a quantum computer, and we need a quantum computational paradigm. Quantum computer, you all know what it is. It's a physical device that can be programmed to efficiently simulate another dynamic of interest. The device, it can be superconductive circuits, it can be trapped ions, ambisenders, whichever the device is. The point is that it has to take advantage of the main features of quantum mechanics, which would be entanglement and superposition. And then it can be able to get exponential speedups over the classical counterparts. We would like to have a fully error-corrected quantum computer that allow us to solve all of these problems that are unreachable by classical supercomputers. But nowadays, we don't have yet reached that point. Nowadays, we have some computers that several companies and research facilities have released, but they belong to this so-called noisy intermediate scale quantum era. This means that the performance of these devices still faces multiple technical constraints. And what is a computational paradigm? Well, computational paradigm is just the criteria behind the implementation of any quantum algorithm into the actual device. It can be any device, but the paradigm is what criteria am I following in order to be able to implement it. Attending to the building blocks that the paradigm employs to change the state of a qubit or to create entanglement and superposition, we can differentiate between two main computational paradigms, which are the digital and the digital analog quantum computation. The first one, the digital quantum computational paradigm, is the most extended one. And it's the one that I'm sure that you have studied in the master degree. It's the one that uses logical gates to change the state of the system. The building blocks are single qubit gates, and these are digital pulses that are applied to one qubit, and they change the state of that single qubit. And to create entanglement and superposition, we use two-qubit gates, which are digital pulses applied simultaneously to two qubits. The single qubit gate has a high fidelity rates when we want to experimentally implement them, but the two-qubit gates face some physical constraint, because whenever you want to apply a two-qubit gate to the system, you have to take the two qubits to the same resonant frequency, isolate them from the rest of the system, and then let them communicate. But this is not going to happen. Normally, they get what is cross that what it called crosstalk. I will talk about you a little bit later. I will talk about this later. But this means that when you have a long depth quantum circuit that you want to implement, you are going to face more noises than you would to a short a quantum circuit. So sorry, I messed a little bit all of the presentation, but focus that if the quantum circuit that we want to implement is short, this digital quantum computational paradigm, the fully digital, is a good idea. But whenever we have a longer depth algorithm, the resources we need to implement this algorithm increases, and also increases the noise that we are facing. As I told you, the single qubit gates are efficient to perform. I think the fidelity rates are around the 99%, so it's almost perfect. And they are so fast that they present almost no noise. Single qubit gates are not a problem right now. But two qubit gates, because of this crosstalk that I told you about, they present significant noise rates, and they accumulate along the process. And this is what makes a long depth circuit to have much more noise than a short one. So crosstalk is an experimental limitation that prevents us to use current devices to advance in the field of quantum computing. But these devices are robust machines, and it is worth working with them. So what if, instead of looking at crosstalk as a problem, what if we can use it as a resource? And that is precisely what the digital analog quantum computational paradigms aims to. So digital analog combines both the digital pulses with analog blocks. Digital pulses would be these single qubit gates that they are perfect to be applied on. And the analog blocks are performed by the time evolution of the interaction Hamiltonian, which is inherent to the quantum processor. What does this mean? Once we communicate to qubit to perform a two-qubit gate in the digital case, we are letting the system communicate. We are letting the qubits communicate, so to speak. They are interacting between each other. So since they are already going to interact with the rest of the system because the isolation is not going to be perfect, what if instead of trying to isolate them, let them interact as they will naturally do? So this is an analog block. Let the system interact as it naturally would have during a certain time. With this, what we get is to change the state of the qubit using the digital pulses, but we create entanglement and superposition using the analog blocks. So the building blocks of the digital analog quantum paradigm would be these ones: digital pulses and analog blocks. So digital analog the digital analog merges the flexibility of digital quantum computing with the robustness of analog simulation, which is this letting interact the qubits among each other. So those resources, single qubit gates and analog blocks, are the only thing that we need to simulate any unitary arbitrarily close. I'm going to exemplify this paradigm, and for that I will focus on a pragmatic model that is ubiquitous in quantum platform, but it could be straightforwardly extended to other specific situations. We are going to use as analog blocks the time evolution of the Hamiltonian that better represent the natural interaction between the qubits, and the digital blocks are going to be single qubit rotations around the x-axis. Let's illustrate this with an example. We are going to simulate an all-to-all two-body inhomogeneous Ising Hamiltonian. I say this slowly because there are so many things before Ising Hamiltonian. The resources will be the interaction Hamiltonian, which is going to be, in this case, an homogeneous Ising Hamiltonian. So the coupling constant is going to be the same for all of the qubits. And this is the mathematical expression of the Hamiltonian. That G is the coupling constant, and those are set entanglement bodies. So that this is why it is a two-body. And then the other resource is going to be single qubit gates, which are going to be this X rotation. So Pauli, X Pauli gates. And our goal is to simulate this all-to-all two-body ISIM set-set Hamiltonian with arbitrary couplings, with the mathematical expression is that one that you see there. So you see that the coupling constant is different for each of the part of the Hamiltonian. Imagine that we have a quantum processor that is built up by three qubits. And since the coupling constant is going to be the same for all of them, because the interaction Hamiltonian is a homogeneous ISIM Hamiltonian, the coupling constant between the qubits are going to be for all that G, only G. So the interaction Hamiltonian is going to look like this. And we are going to, in the next slide, I'm going to use the quantum circuit way to express myself. So each line represents one of the qubits, and we are going to the right as time goes by. So how does this, I'm going to repeat this because I think it's kind of strange, so to speak, when you listen to this at the first time. So I'm going to perform first single qubit digital pulses to the qubits, maybe the first one, the second one, or the third one. But I am also going to let the system interact during the digital, during the analog blocks, during certain times. Okay. Before starting any calculations, just remember that this equality. So if I have a rotation performed on a unitary matrix, and then I apply this dagger rotation, it's the same one, it's the same thing as if I have applied these rotations to the Hamiltonian that is representing this unitary matrix. And if that rotation, which is going to be X gates, is applied to a set matrix, we will have a minus set. So if I have my three qubits and I perform these single qubit rotations to the first one and the second one, then let the system interact during a certain time T1, and then apply the single qubit gates, mathematically, I expect to have this. So X applied to the first qubit, X applied to the second one, the unitary applied during, that's the unitary time evolution of the interaction Hamiltonian during a T1 time. And then I apply the same X rotation, because X dagger it's the same as X, to the first and to the second qubit, using the first equality that I have told you about. We have this other expression. So I take my X gates to the exponent of the exponential, and using the second equality, I get this other expression. I can apply these single qubit rotations to the first one and the second qubit, but I can also apply it to the first one and the third one. And the expression would be similar, but different, because I am going to apply the analog block. I am going to let the system interact during a period of time T2, which is different from T1. But then I apply the same single qubit rotation that I have performed before this interaction. Or I can apply the single qubit gates to the second and the third qubits. And the mathematical expression would be different, but again, similar. So these are the ways that I can apply the single qubit rotations. And let me show you what happens if I apply one after the other. So I apply I apply all of them, these three possibilities. So apply first the single qubit rotation on the first and the second qubit, then the first and the third, and then the second and the third rotation. Well, what I get is this expression, which is just putting all together the expression that I have shown you before. And remember that my goal was to simulate the inhomogeneous all-to-all two-body ISIM Hamiltonian that looks like this. For the case of the qubit, it looks exactly like this. And if you looked, you can see that this constant, T1 minus T2 minus T3, or in the other case, minus T1 plus T2 minus T3, or minus T1 minus T2 plus T3, they can be related to this coupling constant, inhomogeneous coupling constant of the inhomogeneous ISIM two-body Hamiltonian. So in the end, using this digital analog paradigm, the only mathematical operation that I have to do is to find a map between this constant and the other one. So I have only to, I only have to solve a linear system of equations, so I am able to know the value of the time that I'm going to let the system interact. So I need to find the value of T1, T2, and T3. The rest of the things I already know. So this digital analog paradigm allows me to implement, to simulate a complicated Ising Hamiltonian using the natural resources that I have in the quantum processor and some single qubit rotations that are almost perfect, so to speak. To have more information about this procedure, and I mean, because I have shown you an example, but if you want to know more about it and see the general, even more general expression of this, you can take a look to this article, which is the first one that we have developed in this topic. The approach that I have described to you is, it's called actually stepwise DAQC. And the only thing that you need to know is what you already know. It's you, the interaction between the qubits, it switches on and off between the digital blocks. I mean, as you have seen, I first apply single qubit gate to one, to two of the qubits, then let the system interact during T1. Then I apply the single qubit rotations to two different qubits, let the system interact during another time, and then apply the single qubit rotations to another two qubits and let the system interact during another amount of time. And the what I get after performing this operation is exactly the same thing as I would have get if I have applied the fully digital procedure. So this is this implementation, this stepwise DAQC is universal in the sense that it's the same that I would have get using the fully digital one. But this turning on and off of the interaction among the qubits, whenever I have a long depth quantum algorithm, it might lead me to some big errors because this turning on and off interaction, it's including some noise into the system. So what if, since the time that I am going to use to let the system interact is much longer than the time I'm going to use to implement the single qubit rotations, since that time is longer than the other one, what happens if I turn the interaction on and never turn it off until I have finished the complete process? That if I do that, I don't think if that was clear. So I turn on the interaction of the qubits, then I turn it and I don't turn off the interaction until the very end of the process. So the single qubit rotations are performed on top of the interaction of the qubits. That way I am not implementing exactly the same simulation or algorithm as I would have done using either the stepwise or the fully digital one, but the inherent error that I am facing might be much smaller than the error that I am introducing by turning on and off the interaction or by using two qubit gates. And this is precisely what we have seen in some of our studies that I am going to show you right away after this slide. But this, let me tell you, this bank, the AQC, would look something like this. So I let the qubits interact, turn on the interaction, and I don't turn it off. I apply the single qubit rotations on top of that interaction. Maybe the first one and the second qubit, then I go to the second one and the third one, and then I go to the first one and the third one, and the interaction never stops until I have finished all of these operations, and then I turn it off. So before showing you the results that we get, so we can compare the error we face by employing each of the paradigms, let me show you this example of this implementation. So imagine that I want to implement a quantum algorithm that I am sure that you already know, which is the quantum Fourier transform. Quantum Fourier transform is an ubiquitous subroutine that takes place in almost all of the big algorithms in quantum computing. So it's a really important quantum algorithm, but the way, I mean, okay, the more the qubits I need to implement it, the more the depth of the algorithm is. And I think that for 5 qubits, the errors that I get experimentally are so huge that I am not able to implement them. So this is an interesting quantum algorithm to study, because it's important and we are not able to implement it right now. So the digital, the fully digital implementation of this algorithm looks like that. As you can see, we have single qubit gates, which are the Hadamard gate. And we have 2-qubit gates that are going to create this entanglement, which are two different control gates. I can implement exactly the same algorithm using the stepwise digital analog paradigm, which would be this kind of implementation. And I can implement almost the same algorithm, but not the same. We have some errors, as I have told you, using the bank algorithm. So let's see what happened when I implement the quantum Fourier transform using 3 different paradigms. We have a work on this, and we have performed some simulation introducing as many errors as we can think about and that we are able to. So we are able to compare fairly how does the implementation of a same algorithm using different paradigms looks like. So what are the noise sources that we are expecting to have in these 2 paradigms? We are going to face experimental errors whenever we apply single qubit gates in both the digital and the digital analog paradigm. But only we are going to face experimental errors when we apply 2-qubit gates in the digital paradigm, because digital analog doesn't use 2-qubit gates because they are so noisy and we are trying to avoid them. As well as we are going to experiment some errors whenever we apply analog blocks in the digital analog, but not in the digital one. The rest of the errors, they are going to be in both paradigms. We are taking into account measurement error, bit flip error, decoherence, and thermal relaxation. We have taken all of these errors. We have put it into a software that one of our master students have developed, which is Paula Garcia. In fact, we have this new article that has been out today in the archive. I have the reference here in this slide. So we have put together all of these errors. We have simulated the quantum Fourier transform up to 6 qubits, which is the bigger amount that I think in the paper we have more qubits, but here you have in the figure you have 6 because it's easier to look at it. But I mean, for 9 qubits, it was almost 3 weeks until our classical computer was able to simulate it. So we got as far as we could. So we have introduced all of these errors, and to see what's happening in the different paradigms, we are using as a figure of merit the fidelity between the ideal simulation, which is no noise at all, and the noisy simulation for the 3 paradigms: digital, stepwise DAQC, and bank DAQC. And we have applied the quantum Fourier transform to the family of state that you have at top of this slide. So in the figure, we can see many things, but let me focus on the 6-qubit case, which is the deepest algorithm in this example. As you can see, the fidelity that we get for the fully digital implementation, which is the one that we are using nowadays, is, well, the numbers are bad because we are facing the worst case scenario. Normally, quantum devices are much better, so the fidelity we expect it to be higher, but the point is not the number of the fidelity, but the way the fidelity between the different paradigms is related between each other. So the fidelity of the digital is, of the fully digital, is here and is higher than the fidelity we have for the stepwise DAQC, but both of them are lower than the fidelity we get whenever we apply this bank digital analog protocol. So what I told you is real. So we expect that the inherent error we get by not turning the interaction off until the very end of the process, that error is scales much better than the error we get by applying two-qubit gates or by applying the stepwise, so turning on and off the interaction between the digital pulses. And this repeated for all of the cases we have studied. In the case of 5 qubits, the bank protocol has the higher fidelity of all, and this repeats also for the case of 3 qubits. The bank protocol wins them all. So, and yeah, here is the reference of the paper. It came out today, and here you have more detail about how we have done the simulation, and how we have introduced all of these both coherent and incoherent noise sources. So just to sum it up, what we have seen this evening is that current devices, they suffer from important noise sources whenever we apply a 2-qubit gate. That digital analog is a computational paradigm that it's proposed to overcome this experimental limitation. And the main idea of the digital analog is to get advantage of the natural interaction that arises between the qubits of the processor, instead of treating it as a noise source, which is what the fully digital quantum computation does. I have presented to you a realistic simulation of the implementation of the quantum Fourier transform using these different paradigms. And you have seen that the digital analog, the result that we have seen from the digital analog are so interesting because they present an alternative quantum computational paradigm that allow us to implement long depth algorithms in current devices. And this allow us to go farther in the quantum computing field, not in the future whenever we have a fully corrected quantum computer, but now with the devices that we have. And here you have some of the, well, do I think they are? Yeah, here you have everything that we have worked on the digital analog paradigm. These are all of the references that I think it might be useful to have if you are interested in this paradigm. And with this, I am done. I will presenting my PhD topic, and I am done telling you a little bit of my experience during the PhD and the company world. Sort of, I try to make it as short as possible. But before saying that I am done, I would like to thank both the Universidad Politécnica and Accenture to get in contact with me. And thank you for watching until the very end. Here you have my contact. If you have some question that you want to ask me, or if you want to tell me anything, now you can ask me questions, or you can contact me using those things.
And thank you. Thank you very much, Anna. And sorry for the technical issues of the recording. I think that the presentation has been really, really interesting. And I don't know if anybody has any questions, Manuel or Alberto, or we can finish the presentation here.
In my case, I don't have any question.
No, for my case, not, but just thank you, Anna, again, because it has been a very grateful presentation and it's a very interesting topic. Thank you very much, Anna.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the presentation. Nice to meet you.
Okay. So you want to...